Good afternoon, everybody. As Jenny has said yesterday, after a full day of discussions on different topics, I think this is the first time where the second day is kept for the findings and the recommendations which we are going to put, which was not done before. So after our panel discussions, all the eight what we went through, the moderators and the panelists met in the morning, and as we seen yesterday that the first session was on coaching pre and post license period. The moderator was myself, and the panelists, we had four personalities of Derek, Shabir Ali, Mariano Dias and Pradyum Reddy. And this is a presentation what we are going to put and give it forward to GFTC and GFA for our findings and for them to act on it, and I hope that will be implemented. So if you see the finding what we had done after the panel discussion was, one, GFTC for the last few years has been operating without a technical director, and the coaches are all left for themselves. So the panelists along the other panelists, what discussions what we had was recommending GFTC to appoint a technical director, and one technical director to go for 35 centers, it's an impossible job. So we are also recommending under the technical director to have two assistants, one in the north, one in the south. And the technical director, what we have to do, what the qualifications what he has to have is, he should be a pro diploma license holder. He should be a coach educator. And why coach educator is, we have thought of that he can educate regularly the coaches, mentor them, guide them to get better. So these are the recommendations we are going to put to GFTC. And he should also have an experience in coaching youth teams. So if he is involved in day-to-day coaching, I think the coaches will be much, much better. That was one finding and recommendation. The second finding what we had after our discussion was GFTC has appointed coaches. I just got a list of coaches from Lovejoy, and GFTC has got 67 coaches, which is huge, which is good for football to grow in Goa. But we have only DNC at the moment. So now what is our recommendations for GFTC is, and so far there are no refresher courses which have been done. So we have recommendations to that is, conduct refresher courses for coaches with the help of the technical director, which we have just recommended, and his assistants. Also utilize the services of competent coach educators in Goa. And for Goa at the moment, we have good competent coach educators. We have Pradyum Reddy, we have Mariano Dias, we have Shekhar Kerkar, and we have Kaitano Pino. So why not make use of that? Coaches should be encouraged to obtain a higher license, and GFTC should bear the expenses. For all the coaches who are here, and those who have got DNC, we have recommended that you all should go for an upgrade. Those who are for D, go for C, C, B, and that is how it is wanted. And we have also recommended not only your upgradation, but GFTC can help you in your financial or licenses or whatever it is, how you try to perform in your diploma, and accordingly GFTC will try to financially help you. Now the next finding was, as in our discussions, the salary structure in GFTC has not changed since its formation in 2012, which we were all surprised with. But there is always a time where we can recommend and it can go better. So our recommendations are, change the salary payment structures and incentivize the centers. After trying to change the payment structure, GFTC is also going to look at the centers which are there and which are producing players to play for the state, maybe called for the national camp, which is huge for a coach, because we can understand your development is there on regular basis. Centers that have produced professional players playing for ISA, Line League and State teams. also including in the youth national camps also if they are called. It's a huge thing for a coach from a center that his boy or a girl has been called for a camp. Another finding was lack of competitions for GFBC players. As we know that, as I just said, we had 35 centers, and we were just talking to Franklin, and earlier before COVID, I think there was a very good tournament which was being held from inter-center tournament, and it was going for quite some time. But COVID struck, and then nothing happened. So we are, our recommendations are not only to have festival tournaments, but if the tournament can be revived, right? I think the way Franklin explained, I was happy because it was a very, very detailed one, which a lot of matches are playing. Rules were there that rotation was supposed to be done for players, and some of the coaches, as we gathered, were more interested in performance, not trying to rotate, only looking at the development of the players. We can take care of, but this is another finding. Also, GFBC and GFA to discuss how GFBC can participate in GFA competitions in the future. And the action to be taken is by GFBC and GFA to have discussions, and I hope that will happen and the boys will get a chance to go further. When it comes to professional clubs, any questions which the GFBC center or anyone from the crowd which you have in your mind, can go forward, please. We are preparing him. If the technical director leaves, we should be taking up the responsibility.
Another center, the costs will be included. So
So I think if the budget is there, I think that would be the best venue what we have suggested.
Sir, regarding the recommendation that we have given for festival tournament, I would like to say that if JMBC and JFA together, have these groups and then take them out of the state, so we have a state exposure also.
First of all, we will try to see this thing is sorted out between GFA and GMDC. And once that is done, I think that would be better. But I think a valid point what we have, the moment they go out of the state, it will always help them to understand and to try to get better to play competition.
Okay, as we spoke about upgradation, so we have D licenses. Tomorrow we have to upgrade to C or maybe C to B. A B license course should be coaching the grassroots, because when you have B, we get an opportunity to coach for pro D as assistant. And why B should be here at GMDC? And this
is a good question, but what we have recommended for ranking in our findings, in our recommendations. Now, if GMPC tries to fund you in your license, you have to have a bond of at least 3 years with them. You just cannot leave and go where they are trying to put some money on you. And after 3 years, if they have an offer, why not you leave for a better position? That is fine. But at least see that you upgrade yourself, especially those who are at D, and that will be taken care by the GMPC. And once they are doing it for you, I think it's fair enough to see that at least you stay 2 or 3 years with them. And then if there is a chance for you, if you get a higher package, why not be here this year and go for higher? Completely agree.
Okay.
Good evening, sir. I had a question with regard to the upgrade of license. Now, according to the provisions of GMPC, there's a provision from D to C, C to B, and B to A. But then we have now goalkeeper level 1 license. Now that is also an upgradation, because we have gone through a test, we have gone through a course, but there is no provision for goalkeeper's level when we upgrade for goalkeepers. So our salary structure remains the same, although we have upgraded to a goalkeeper level 1 license. So then if something would be done with regard to that, because for us, even that we consider as our upgradation. And second point, sir, with regard to we are paid on hourly basis. So when the structure of the salary changed, if we can we put into our contractual basis. So what happens is it could benefit both ways. It could benefit the GMDC and for us, because we are under a contract and we stop paying hourly. If that could be done, I mean the technicalities of that could be looked up to how it will be done, whether it's hours or in a year, how the contract is renewed. I wouldn't know that right now, but it could benefit the coaches in the long run, I think.
The hourly payment which was there, which we have discussed, which is not right according to what we have discussed. Because the coaches are also not to be respected only for the hours which we are working for. So we have discussed that, and frankly, we'll take it up. We will try to see that you get a monthly salary according to what you have been paid. But frankly, if you can note down what he has got a valid point for both keeping level 1 to level 2, if there is no salary structure which is there for the other licenses, then it's not right. So we will try to put it across. Yeah, we have noted it down. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
For your recommendation.
Coaches, any more questions?
GFA has asked him to coach the youth team or national team, you mean, state team, you mean?
Yes.
I think you should be allowed, and maybe this point also, if he is allowed, as we have told them to incentivize the centers and the coach, if some player is being called for the youth camps, national camps, state teams, or they go for a higher in the future, I think that also should be taken care of. And something extra should be given for the coach. Because of your quality of your coaching, the state is asking you to come and coach the state team. So that will be surely taken care of.
Also regarding the goalkeeping coaches. Now earlier the goalkeeper coach used to travel whole north of south. So what about that? Because the goalkeeping, the department of goalkeeping is I think neglected.
So we will also try to recommend for the future coaches which have been taken in, if we can look for more goalkeeping coaches, so at least we have 4-5 in the north, 4-5 in the south, where they can move, it will be much better rather than having one and to look out of all the centers, not possible. So another recommendation which we will try to put besides the one goalkeeping level structure, we will also try to put in the recommendations with the GFPC manager. Thank you, Frank. Any more questions? Can we go forward? Thank you. So we come to professional clubs. The second session of the day yesterday, and the topic was changes in the football landscapes, problems faced, threats and expectations. The moderator was Marcus, and the panel was with Mr. Srinivas Dembo, Dr. Sardokar from Dembo, Dr. Sagar Sardokar from Genome. We had Vikram Sardokar from Kloot Sardokar and Ravi Pushkar from FC Goa. So after good deliberations, the findings were the government infrastructure cost for hosting matches and practices at all levels is very high. And it came to a point where we came to say that Goa is having much better infrastructure than compared to the other states. But what is keeping it away are the costs of the grounds and the infrastructure what we have. So that was one of the findings, and recommendations goes to them to reduce the infrastructure cost so that it can be used, especially to clubs promoting football at youth and grassroots. So that is what is our recommendation which we are trying to put to the government. The next finding what in this session, fans don't ever connect with the clubs despite their achievements and don't turn up for matches. You must have seen yesterday when the question was put by Marcus to Baba, and one point which Ravi had mentioned, now a PEX supporter going all the way to Dulher, it's a challenge because to go and come back. But Baba gave a point earlier which even a fan from Pichoni used to come and watch their games in Samsung. But times are changing and we can't go according to what we had. So the findings, how to connect with the clubs, the fans, the recommendations were clubs should step out and connect with the community now, which also Mr. Srinivas therefore agreed that we have to do a little bit more connect with the community. Unless there is engagement, fans won't show up and support the teams at stadiums or grounds. A stronger connect is needed. So that is what was the finding among the panelists, and this was the recommendation which we are going to put across. The finding, over 20% of the stadium capacity tickets are given as complimentary, and not even 5% of the ticket holders turn up at the stadium. As we all know, matches are there, we ask with friends, we ask with somebody, can we get matches, but it's very sad and shameful that we don't even attend matches when we get free. So the recommendations are reduce the complimentary tickets. Follow the international patterns where the number of free passes is minimum. So when the passes are minimum, and if you are really wanting to go to the stadium to watch the match, you are bound to buy a ticket and go for the match. So that is one of the finding recommendations what we have given. The fourth one was, despite social media growing at an alarming rate, and having a major influence on people's lives, though clubs have been slow to use of it. And the recommendation is, clubs should put social media to better use and connect with its fans spread all over. The discussion was yesterday about how you can connect with handles of Instagram, then Twitter, which is changed to, and this is what is the finding what we are coming up with. Another finding which was done is many fans find the match timings inconvenient due to inadequate public transport and office workouts. And if you see the timings of ISL, it is starting at 7:30. People coming from far can find it difficult. But our recommendations are, preferably have the matches on weekends and not on a weekly basis. That is what is the recommendation, which we will see how far it is going to be. The last one in this was finding, as pointed out by FC Goa, they are being charged a very high amount for usage of Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium that they host their home matches, while places like Odisha, Northeast, Bengal, Hyderabad, others are given the grounds for free at times or subsidized lease. This leads to high cost of tickets in Goa because all of us are complaining the ticket prices are very, very high in Goa. But FC Goa has to spend about more than 45 lakhs in a match to host. So imagine how are they going to go ahead if every time they have to spend so much of money. So the recommendation is FC Goa should not be treated as a purely commercial club, as they are incurring heavy losses at present. They are the only club from Goa in the Indian Super League, which is officially the top tier league in India. So recommendation is, can the rates of the stadium hosting matches be subsidized? And if that can be done, FC Goa is surely going to see that the rates, ticket rates are also being taken care of. Now, any more questions which you have on professional clubs? I think, Vilas, you had one.
Mine is a suggestion. Like, you know, this last 3 months, there were so many inter-village tournaments. If you go to see, you know, recently we have World Silver Trophy at Haveli. There were nearly 5,000 spectators. If you go to see Girdwani in Chandor, there also for the semi-finals itself, there were nearly 3,000 spectators. But if you go to see Raya Sporting Club tournaments, there were nearly 10,000 spectators. So my suggestion is that you all should get them, the organizers, one meeting, like what they are doing to get the spectators there. And the professional teams or the clubs, what I am saying, we should have the home matches on their particular grounds, or the home team should play on their ground. So that is my suggestion as such. Thank you.
GMP has tried their best by opening up the gates, by giving matches free for Patalkar and whatever league matches also are happening. But it's surprising that even after the gates been open, crowds are not coming, which we all know, which whatever you said in us is very true, because why inter-village? So one thing what we have discussed was, inter-village can be more because locals are playing, their whole family is trying to go, their neighborhood is trying to go. That is what, if you remember, I think if I can recollect, Baba had mentioned why Tempo Sardongar, why not Mopsa, why not play in the name of the villages. That is what was his, one of the suggestions what he has got, and your suggestion is right, because when we get people storming to see games in inter-village, why not here, even when the gates are open. So only one reason what I can feel is, I just said, because they are locals, their families come, their friends come, and that is how the crowds are there for inter-village tournaments.
So can I move to the second clip? Yeah, the media.
Social media?
Yes, yes. Now regarding social media, On the social media, you will get only the news of ISL going everywhere. In Goa, if you ask a boy or a girl from a village, do you know how many matches are being played in Goa every day? They don't know because they read the Marathi newspapers and they do not display as we get in Herald or Navin today's sports. It is not displayed in these newspapers. So we have to reach to the farthest corner of each and every part of Goa. Every day we have a hidden village match. The children don't know what is this. Yes. So to be aware, I think this is the other newspapers also should print. Maybe it is hidden village match. Maybe it is age group match. Maybe it is GPL. All these things should be displayed. Media is not covering. Then they come to the coaches and ask, is there any selection? He asks them, why don't you read the newspapers? The Marathi newspapers do not display this. So they do not know about it.
You mean in the print media, only the English papers try to carry this?
Yes.
The other mediums don't.
So we will only portray the big clubs.
Okay. So we'll try to make a note of it and suggest it so that it comes there. But this social media of Instagram and all, if each club tries to do it on their own, I think that would be much, much better and much more valued in the future. But we will take your point frankly and we will try to recommend it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, so, yes, if you speak about this 20% tickets that are given as complimentary. Now, as we know, inter-village clubs are more connected to people. Okay. Why can't we provide this 20% taking good intermediaries and providing to the clubs? When these small clubs, inter-village clubs show participation in this tickets, automatically they will pull around the other people who are connected to the clubs. See, what happens is, I'm not saying that, you know, FC Goa owners will go and give the tickets to the people. There may be intermediaries who are giving it to the clubs. Who are these intermediaries? Are they connecting to the right people? Are we getting those 20% tickets to the right people? What if these 20% tickets are being provided to the right intermediaries, to the right clubs? Take it as inter-villages only. Or for example, if we are providing these 20% tickets to our GMTC centers, their kids, maybe they will have more interest in going to the matches. Maybe we can even provide transport for them to go for these matches. What about that?
Yes, I mean, tickets are distributed as complimentary tickets are actually given. I don't know whether there's a policy where the club owner, when Kaitana was elected as the president of the GFA, he pledged that every club in the state which is registered to the GFA as a professional, amateur, whatever it is, each club is given 3 tickets. So we do give it to the right people, right? But beyond that, there are also other elements, right? We also have to get permissions, etc., and it also has to go to government offices, government officials, and other people. Now, we cannot say no to them because they are also using their infrastructure. So, and honestly, the point is not whether who we give these 20% to. I think the important thing is what it says about them. We should reduce that 20%.
No, since those 5% people are coming, that's the reason I put up this point. Why not give it to those who actually willing to come? Maybe it is 20% or whatever percent.
Yeah.
I just hope that it goes to the right people.
No, our intention is to take out the 20%. Why should it be 20%? Why should it not be only 5% that goes out in public? 5% should go to the people who are paying to be a sponsor of the club and so forth, because they're paying for those tickets in an indirect way. They should, but why should anything else be complimentary?
No, not just complimentary. I'm just saying, since they do not turn up, that's why. That's why it's gracious enough to give 20%.
No, we don't want to be that gracious to give up 20%. We want to bring that down. That's the whole point, that we want to bring it down to 5%.
Okay, but then
this 20%, can I get it a little bit?
Sure.
Yeah, this 20% you are talking about for village clubs, every club should get, you mean?
No, no, not every club. Whatever, even if it is 5% also, why not give it to those clubs or who are interested, who will literally turn up in the stadium?
Yeah, you cannot say who is going to turn up, but according to GFA, every club gets 3 tickets which are there and it cannot go more than that. Then how are they going to survive? If it is 5% for every club, we have more than 100 clubs in Goa registered.
Not every club. Even if they are providing 5% also, with the right intermediaries, let the tickets go to the right people.
Right. So we give GFA close to about 500-550 tickets, right? For the number of clubs that there are, right? You're saying that they would all turn up, right? The redemption rate for that is not more than 55%, 60%. So I am giving it to a football loving audience who are invested in the sport, who play the sport, who also conduct the sport. And even then they're not showing up. Because giving it to the person with the right intention is there, the person receiving it is there with the right intention, but sometimes they might pass it on to somebody else who is not interested. The problem is, because that ticket is free of cost, it is a piece of paper. When you pay for that, then that has a value against it. Even if the value is 10 rupees, it's still a value, right? So when you put money down from your own pocket for some service, you will ensure you get complete service for that. If I give you a piece of paper, which is also the ticket, then you're like, it's a piece of paper, I can throw it away, it holds no value.
So what if you try it with our centers, JFDC centers, providing FPs? Just a short, let's give it a short answer.
Yeah, I think what he's trying to say is that you're okay with saying that you're giving it to the GFA guys. If they are not turning up, that's what he's trying to say. In a sense, if they are not turning up, don't give them the ticket next time. Make sure you go and give it to somebody else who would actually turn up. So I think maybe what he's trying to say is you should have a more effective way of tracking the free tickets. Implementing a kind of a ban on people who are not turning up and then making sure that, you know, like you said, yes, give it to somebody else, that person turns up, you're getting your crowd and that will pull in further crowd. You bring it down to 5%. Okay, I don't think he's objecting to that. But the tracking mechanism of making sure that if you're giving out a ticket, get a crowd in, that's what he's trying to say.
I mean, it's very difficult to track. I get what you're saying, but it's very difficult to track because I might buy the ticket, but I might not attend the match myself, right? I might look at you. I might be able to pattern. Now, how do you, say as a person who issued the ticket, figure out which one of them is turning up or whether I've got it, then I'm turning up, right? So each one will use the ticket in the way that they feel necessary to use the best. So it's very difficult to track who's showing up and who's not. I can know the percentages, but I won't know. So I'm giving 300 or 600 tickets. People will come and collect it. Now, how do you know which of those 600 showed up and which ones didn't?
Yeah, you know, maybe something like ISL Media Acquisition. We give our names. So the same way, if you're giving out the name, that's who you're giving it to, that person has to come in somehow. See, it might be a little bit of an inconvenience initially, but once you get your crowd, then you don't need to bother about it and then you can go labs.
Yeah, I mean, I get what you're saying, but it's very tough to implement because the volumes are high. Like media accreditation is 30 people. Here we're talking about close to, I mean, 20% of the stadium capacity.
You want to bring it down to 5.
My intention is 5. Ideally, I would like it to be 0, but we have to do something.
Can we go ahead? Any more questions on professional clubs? Or can we move ahead? Okay, we go next to amateur clubs. That was the third topic of the day. And the topic was changes in football landscape, problems faced, threats and expectations. The moderator was Albert Molasso. The panelists were from Kalakot Association, Dr. Anthony Lobo. From Garden Angel Sports Club, John C. Fernandez. From Goa Valley Sports Club, Arnel Fernandez. And Navali Sporting and Salsed FC was Shubha Chutani. So the findings, once the discussion was finished yesterday and today when we got with the finding and the recommendations, the finding was as the Goa League is played during the monsoon, the only stadium where matches can be played is the GFA Stadium. And that too in Dulair and Mopsa. For clubs like Garden Angel and others from South Goa, that involves a lot of travel. The recommendation was, if the government along with SG should build at least 2 artificial turf grounds in the north and south with proper facilities like dressing room and facility capacity. And proper artificial grounds, we are talking about proper football stadiums, no track or anything. So that the stadium is compact. That is what is the recommendation which we are going to give to the government, which will see that the travel is cut down from south to north, north to south. And the action has to be taken by SG. The next point finding was many clubs who have been doing a lot of work for many years at the grassroots and youth level are training on their own and face the problem of not having proper coaches. The recommendation is GFDC centers, if they can tie up with local clubs and schools to provide the necessary technical and financial support. That is the recommendation which we have put. Don't know how far we can go ahead with that and whether it will be action against to be taken by GFTC. The third one was many few new players are coming up as they are losing interest in the game due to other easily available entertainment options. And the recommendations given are school headmasters and authorities doing along with the parents should try to impress on the young children that social media and health benefits of practicing sports regularly. It's a big challenge with the parents, big challenge with the big challenge for coaches because we can't see much of the kids coming on the field, but that is what is one of the recommendations what we are giving. The fourth point was in finding due to increase in the clubs at all levels, the number of matches have increased and quality has been compromised. And the recommendation is there should be a temporary moratorium on affiliation to new clubs and GFA should review the performance of the existing clubs. What has happened of late is because GFA is encouraging clubs to come, especially at the younger youth groups, 13, 15. There are village clubs who are coming, which is good to increase participation, but is there enough quality in that? That is what it means, because some of the teams are being battered by 6-0, 7-0, 8-0. And we are thinking about not only about the result, but we are thinking about the confidence of the boy who has lost badly. Is he good enough? Will he be good enough to come and play the next game? So that is what is the recommendation for GFA to see if the new clubs are being not given more affiliation and should check on the existing clubs and their performance. Officials, another finding, officials of many clubs due to continued presence in their managing committees have become lethargic. Staying at the clubs for too long, taking everything for granted. And the recommendation is clubs should rotate their officials regularly and approach competent people in the locality to support the clubs, particularly in new technology and social media. Get younger blood inside, keep rotating so that new ideas will come from the younger generation which to come. Another point finding which was discussed, clubs are always looking for funds for their activities. Recommendation is clubs should be in the active register of SAP so that they can avail of grants and other facilities. Some clubs they are lacking and we don't know that there are a lot of grants which are available with the sports authority, but try to see that, go through the roles and try to avail of these facilities which are there. Before we go further, any questions on amateur clubs, on the recommendations and the findings?
So can we go to the earlier clip? Before that? Yes. Now regarding, do we really want football to be spread all over Goa or to be concentrated only in pockets of Salsette and Bardez?
Nothing all over Goa.
Yes, so we should have stadiums in the Ponda Taluka, one which can be used as a neutral venue. Then other talukas are also there where there are no stadiums. There are always matches in Duler and in the south. But in Ponda, there are no matches at all. We cannot hold matches also. That time, the GFA can have a neutral venue for the teams. So why don't they build stadiums all over Goa?
So for the moment, we don't know whether this is going to be accepted. For the moment, we recommended only two. And not to differentiate between talukas, not to differentiate between anywhere. But this is a recommendation which we have put, whether not knowing whether it will happen or not. Once this happens, also put
there. Yeah, our sports minister is from Ponda. I have already told him about this.
Told him
have a ground in Ponda.
Told whom about it?
Our sports minister.
Then you come, sports minister and no football ground.
We want a football ground. So only through sports minister's recommendation we can have a ground in Ponda. And
so you have a football ground?
Yes.
So you still want one more?
We don't have a football ground.
You don't have?
We don't have. So we bought one.
Okay. So the meeting what you had with the sports minister, what was the discussion?
I was not there for that discussion.
Okay. Let's keep it away. Okay, we'll take your suggestion, Frankie. Any more questions?
Sir. Yeah.
Regarding the GFPC tying up with the clubs, I think there should be a MOU signed between that the GFA first of all accepts GFPC to be tied up with the GFPC.
The club is already registered with GFA. So there is no much thing which you have to do, and GFPC can involve themselves.
So I think there should be some MOU signed between the club and the GFPC center or something.
Yeah, like that you can discuss. But since the club is already registered and affiliated by GFA, the discussion between GFPC center and the club can be done, and something you can work it out.
But you have mentioned only GFPC. I am saying if GFA also has to be, because in their AGM they may just discard that.
Discard who? The clubs?
Yeah, GFA clubs are the members are there in their AGM.
Okay.
They may just discard GFPC because long time we had this problem.
In the previous one, we have discussed that there should be discussion between GFPC and GFA. That is what we are recommending, and I hope, we all hope here, that both these bodies come together for the development of the game. So the players' perspective was the fourth topic of the day, and the moderator was Lector Mashkar Ennis. The panel was all ex-players, Bhivan DiMello, Kenan Almeida, Denzel Franco, and Brahmanan Shangwalkar. Was after finishing their football playing days, many players are unemployed and facing financial hardships, which we have seen so many. And the recommendations what we have, players should look for post-retirement football-related careers like one is coaching, refereeing, administration, physical training during their playing careers itself. Yesterday, if you remember in the first session, Derek had brought a point that he came into coach education only after his retirement, which was too late. So we are recommending that during the playing career, if they can start going through their batches, I think by the time they retire, they have already a career path. So that would be very, very good for, and there are many which can be chosen. The second point which was recommend, which is a recommendation, government to provide employment opportunities to retire players and to fill up the sports quotas in government departments. There are quotas which are supposed to be there, I think 4% or something in the government, so that GFPC, they can try to see who are the ones who are really needed and fill up those posts which are there in sports quotas. Players should also be aware of job opportunities in central government institutions like customs and central excise. And we have a very good example where the moderator himself was there, superintendent of customs. So I think Lector can give them some tips to be there. Right, Lector? The other job quotas for players who win national level competitions at the senior level and represent the country, which is one more recommendation, which would help the players after their playing career, they have something to look for. And the avail of skill development opportunities provided by planning. This point was brought up by Franklin, where there are so many skill development opportunities are there. If we can introduce it to the coaches, to the players when they are playing, so that they know that once I am retired out of the game, there is something for me to look for. The other finding which we came is most of the present GFPC administrators are currently gainfully employed and do not have time to administer their centers where the staff is not big enough. So recommendations are there, GFPC should appoint former local players and administrators if you can, which gives them also an opportunity to see for a job and to look for their careers in the future. The next, before we go further, any questions on players' perspective?
Coaches, any questions on players' perspective? Especially the people who have been players and you know have the experience playing. So any questions from your side? Marcus? Rafi?
Some players before, now they are having opportunities or maybe having into coaching, refereeing, administration, physical and so on. My point is, now they will be working as a coach or a referee for many years, maybe 5, 6. Okay, my friend over here has been working in JRTC for the last 10 years, but still I don't think he has a security in his job. So at some point, don't we feel that they must have a permanent kind of a security? Because football is a very long way, a long process. So coaches as such should get some permanent security in their job. Because if they have, maybe they'll try to give more extra effort.
I think the call will be taken by GFPC. We will try to recommend them whether they are going to be permanent or whether, frankly, you want to answer that?
Because at the end, they were players before. And at some point, they have become some maybe coaches, referee and so on.
Because I would leave it to GFPC for them to decide, and that would be the recommendation or suggestion which I would give when we have voted it down already.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Any more? Okay, so we go to Intervillage, the fifth topic of the day, and the topic was about Intervillage football tournaments and their role in keeping football passion alive at grassroots level, and what more can be done in the present scenario. The moderator was Patrick Rizzardo. The panel was from Raya Sporting Club. It was Francisco Cardozo from Chandor Club. Joy De Silva from Benauling. It was Anthony Rodriguez. And from Scioli Marna, it was John Pereira. So the finding was most of the matches do not start on time, with teams playing each half of less than 35 minutes, thereby significantly reducing the playing time. Our recommendation to GFA is to ensure that matches start on time so that each half is at least of 35 minutes. When I was there in the technical committee, I had suggested if you see in a top international match, the ball in play is round about 50 or 60 minutes for a game of 90 minutes. And when we have in the inter-village one half of 25 and one half of 20, we don't know whether it's because of the referees start late, whether it's because of the players. And if by chance one team scores a goal, the ball is kicked out most of the time. The player in a game in 90 minutes touches only 2 to 2.5 minutes. So if international level is at that extent, the players and the ball in play is only 50, 60 minutes. If you play a game of 45 minutes, 20 and 25, how our inter-village football is going to develop and develop players where we have grown playing inter-village tournaments. Big concern. So it's all, not only the GFA, it has to be the referees, it has to be the players, everybody come together so that at least we play 70 minutes of inter-village game that has to be done. The next finding is players are still skipping inter-village matches to play open on recognized tournaments. Discussion was GFA should ensure that no player registered with them takes part in open tournaments. If anyone is found playing, strict action should be taken. There was some action taken in the last few years where players were suspended, they were asked to pay fines, the clubs were asked to pay fines. So I think GFA should act upon it. Why do players go to play open tournaments? Only because of money. And the inter-village is suffering, so I think that was one of the finding and recommendation what we have done. The third point was in the world, tournaments have stopped in many villages. These tournaments previously provided a platform for budding players to showcase their talent and then move up. The recommendation are, village clubs should be encouraged to conduct inter-world tournaments on a regular basis, which gives a lot of chance for the youngsters in that particular village, in that particular ward, to take part and get better. The next one is, quality of inter-village matches has dropped. Senior or retired players should be encouraged to obtain coaching licenses and take charge of village teams so that they can bring in some quality. A point to be debated, and it can go on for long, but just a recommendation is there. If there is somebody to guide, to mentor the young players, I think that would be a lot more better. The last finding is only one inter-club tournament is held at the moment. Only one inter-club tournament is held at the moment. So the recommendation to GFA should look at the possibility of organizing more inter-club tournaments, particularly during pre-season, where the squad which is there can be rotated and the coach of the club can understand what is the playing combination, what he can get. So that is what we have recommended. Any questions on this topic before we move to the fun?
We have a village tournaments, many are going on, but they are only for seniors. Why not our juniors can have it, maybe under 15 village tournament, under 13, anyone? Why not?
Up to you. This is just recommended because it is not big enough. And if before under 15, if we can have an inter-world tournament for the boys, that would also be a big boost, because at a younger level, if you get more matches to play, I think that would be.
Yes.
So it's all up to the club. If you want to go under 13, under 15, I think that would be a boost, higher than advantage, because they will get more number of matches.
No, not just as a club, but also, I am saying intervening, because when it comes to a club, maybe maybe we'll have boys from, okay, one is from Manhattan, one from Manali, and maybe some different boys, because we select quality. But when it comes to intervening, what will happen is, those boys from the village will be able to play. Maybe some are not that good, but there is a sure guarantee that they get chance to play. At least that much is guaranteed. So because when it comes to club, what happens is, you may select one boy from there. You will make a good team, maybe under 18, 15, 13. But when it comes to intervening, you don't have a choice. If he's in that vicinity, you'll have to make him move. So this way our kids will get the chance.
Yeah, I think good point, but still inter-village tournaments which I had, which cards from different zones are playing by showing them that we are in state level. But a good point which we can take forward. Okay, thank you. The next one, topic number 6 was grassroots, youth football and academics. And the moderator was Pratyum Reddy. The panel was Luis Barreto of South Goa United, Nelroy Maura from Cesar Goa, Nathaniel DiCosta, Costa Foundation, Bruno Cupino, Aurelion, and Francisco Nunes from Chicago. The finding was lack of competitions for younger age groups has hampered progress of the youngsters. And the recommendations which we gave are have more collaborations with all stakeholders to ensure more games and access to facilities. For sure, we know that when they are young, if they have more competition, which can develop our players into better decision-making players, which we are lacking. Another finding is GFPC inter-center tournaments previously had good opportunities for the players and coaches to showcase their skills, which we already discussed before. So revive the GFPC center tournaments that existed pre-COVID and ensure we have better scouts at this tournament so that any talented player does not escape attention. That is one more recommendation. Another finding was age group teams are identified and trained just a month or less before any national competition. So the recommendation to the state's age group team should train for a longer time and a month before the competition. Teams should be selected at the district level, which trains possibly once a week to start with all through the year. The next finding in this grassroots youth football and academies is it becomes difficult for clubs to organize competitions since the facilities are expensive. Clubs or private stakeholders shy away from organizing tournaments due to the high cost. The recommendation are provide facilities for free or lower cost for youth teams to conduct tournaments. Clubs can also organize more competitions for lower age groups with GFA and SAG providing all possible help. Any questions before we go for the seventh topic?
Coaches, this is about the grassroots, so I'm sure you all will have questions since you all are GFPC coaches.
So regarding the state age group team, in 2012, GFA had organized the Taluka level team. From there, they had a competition and then the state team was selected. If the same thing is continued, we can have a good state team at the age group. And that year the team which was selected was the runners up in under 15. And one of the boys was selected for Bajaj Alliance. So Bajaj Alliance, they had taken him for an international tour. So same thing if JFA continues now, instead of having 1 month before prior selection, we can start 2 or 3 months before Taluka level or zone level. JFA has got 3 zones. We can have the teams in that way and can select the best team after playing matches.
I completely agree with you, Ramesh, and I remember when we were playing for Dr. B.C. Roy tournament in 83, we had 2 teams, one red and one blue in north and south, and that was done after selections and which continued after the tournament, and we won the tournament in Goa, and recommendations have been given to GFA and hope GFA tries to accept this suggestion and tries to go further. Thank you, Ramesh. Any more questions?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening, Amrita. Since GFPC has stopped organizing tournaments for the kids, there are clubs associated with the GFPC, which the clubs feed their kids. If GFPC can help those trainees to participate in the GFA tournament, then it will be better, sir. So that kids also get the opportunity to play in the competition.
This is what has been discussed now. So GFA and GFPC will try to see how best GFPC can be included in the tournaments. If that is not the case, then the second point which you raised, GFPC can align with the club so that the boys are not only training but trying to play competition also. That has been discussed. Point taken, and we will try to take it forward.
See, we are talking of organizing matches, but at present, the refereeing department, we are not getting referees. Now, practically, referees these days are officiating 3 to 4 matches a day, and then the quality also is down, and then organized matches becomes a big problem. One thing we have to see is the refereeing department, so that more matches can be organized since there are referees. At present, we are facing a big problem. No one is taking up refereeing. So if we don't have a referee, difficult to have a match.
So you mean there are no younger generation which is
taking up the referee?
The point for GFA, I will see that you have more referees. Thank you, Ashwin.
Then regarding grassroots, another recommendation which I can't find here. See, the kids till the primary, they are saying from 6 to 8, 9, they are the primary. Now the primary school, they don't have a PE teacher. There is no one to take care of them. If a PE teacher is appointed or in clusters and some balls are thrown on the ground, they'll start playing football. And since football is a state team, I think the subject, at least for the lower classes, has to be compulsory. So the moment more people now, if parents are free, we take the boy to the ground. But if the coach comes to the school, we have boys ready in the school.
I think this point was discussed by Derek, if you remember yesterday, when John had called him and told him regarding PE teachers. At the moment, PE teachers are very well dressed by looking at all the disciplines. If he or she is a football one, which can be used. If not, there are big challenges for PE teachers to look after that. And I completely agree with your point of view, because they, at that particular age group, nobody is trying to take care of them. And if we have, when FC Goa is trying to have their little girls league, I think most of the GMPC students who are there in the centers, which they have their league, are participating. But if it is done in the school, there is nothing like it. So we will try to put up your point.
So another question.
Yes, please.
Yeah, good evening, sir. So in the age group competition, under 13, under 15, under 17, in the Division 1, we have a lot of matches. But in the Division 2, the number of matches are very less. So it affects the development of a child who is playing in the Division 2. And it is not that we are getting good players from the Division 1 only. So there are good players playing in the Division 2 also. Like we had two players who were playing in Division 2 in our team last year. So those two players were selected for Lenovo. And then they went on to play, they are selected for Bayern Munich, that tournament is there, they are selected there. And last year they played only 4 matches in the Division 2. So it depends the development of the players who are playing in the Division 2. So the number of matches, if it could increase, that it will help in the development of the players. Ultimately, they are also the players who have potential and who can go on to the higher divisions.
The idea of having two divisions from GFA was to see that not to have one division and to have all the teams, and some teams who are not very, very competitive and get lost, as I was just talking. In my sporting got lost in under 13, 8-1. But there are teams which lose that team. So that was the reason what we were looking, GFA is looking at, to build a platform for them and then to take them to tier 1. You are completely right, Johnson, when you are saying tier 1 also teams are not good. Completely agree. So now the introspection has to go on, and we will try to see which are the ones, because at that level we don't want only the matches to be played, we want the matches to be competitive. We don't want big scores, because it throws down the confidence of the boy or girl completely low, and the woman, the boy or the girl goes home, the first question the parents ask, what happened to the match? And if the boy or the girl says, we lost 7-0, 5-0, the parents not knowing about the game, why do you go? You better sit at home. So keeping that in mind, I think that was the idea of having 2 tiers and not to have more separate things. But right now, what GFA has to introspect is, after the first year matches are over, are they good enough, or are there some to be brought down, so the second tier also get enough number of matches? That is what we will be discussing with GFA to look into. Johnson.
Yes, sir. That was my point. Like, if we could have more matches in the tier 2, the players will also get a competitive environment, and they actually require more matches in the tier 2. I can understand GFA's point also, because some of the village clubs, they don't want to play more number of matches. They want to play just 5 or 6 matches and finish it off, because they have some financial issues. That is also a big problem.
In tier 1, 14 teams has to be there, because that is the criteria of GFA to see every GPL team has to have 13 and 15. So 14 matches are gone, teams are gone there. So still three more teams are there besides this one. So in the second year and in the first year, after the competition gets over, I think introspection has to be done, and then have seen that second year also gets enough number. But if you go to see, we are also asking GFA not to affiliate more teams so that at that level they don't get killed with the results what happened and the confidence go down. So it's a balance what GFA is to look for, to look at the development and the results what are happening at the moment. Johnson, okay?
So, regarding the primary schools, they don't have PE teachers cannot maybe teach football. So I would say if the MPC provides some small incentive to the coaches who are there and who can go to the schools, maybe our coaches will be able to train the little boy and encourage them to play football.
I think there is one thing what the GPM clubs used to do before, few clubs used to do, is adopt schools. And when you adopt schools, you tell the school that we adopt the school to help you to coach the players from our certified coach. Of late, which is not happening. But we will try to recommend GFPC if their coaches can come and help the schools where the PE teacher, sir, or teacher who is not very competent in the game, I think that would be much better. We will try to do it.
So coming to the Division 2 matches, they are playing very few matches. So why don't we conduct the Division 2 matches, and after finishing, let's start with the first division for the age group. So the players who have played in the second division, let them get promoted or play for the first division teams.
So if you bring this player, the players who are in the first division, they will go up again.
No, sir, the talented player like Johnson has brought to the notice, the good talented players, some of the villages, what they do, they want to make them play in the lower division. So they are talented, we finish the second division first and then start with the second division, we can promote the same players.
In the first division, you will have talented players, not all.
Not all, sir. You are
some of them will not be.
Yes, sir.
So in the second division, once they finish, you take the talented players, talent versus talent, and the one which was there in the first division, they are not a license to play.
No, but sir, to get the level at a higher level, if the talented players are not getting the opportunity, they are playing just two or three matches. Very, some teams are just one or two players who are playing good, and the team is just good just because of them. So if those talented players can be promoted to the first division, that will benefit for them and they will get more number of matches also.
For the only the talented one, what about not the talented one?
They are already playing, no, sir. They are getting the chance in the second division. Let them play.
So the talented ones gets more matches, you mean?
Yes.
Okay, we'll try to put on a suggestion. Any more questions or we go to the next one? The next one was infrastructure. And the topic was development of infrastructure and how it can be best utilized for football. The moderator was Jonathan D'Souza. Panel members were representative of SG, Dr. Geeta S. Nagwekar. Representative of GFA was the president, Dr. Caetano Fernandez. Representative of ISL club was Ravi Pushkar. And former AIFF General Secretary, Sir Albert Kulasso. The finding was infrastructure was the strain is poorly maintained, reasons lack of funds, lack of skill, manpower. The recommendation is mark higher allotment in sports budget, so the sports budget can be increased a little bit more than what we have at the moment, particularly for maintenance of sports infrastructure. Giving the infrastructure on lease to private entities with a properly defined policy. In our discussion, we came to know that some of the grounds were given to the panchayats, they had to pay some fees and the panchayat can lease it out to, not all the grounds are done like that. So if we can define a proper policy where the infrastructure is being used and the ones who are being used can maintain it also. In Goa, we have infrastructure but the biggest challenge what we have is the maintenance. So that is what is the finding, recommendation what has come out. The next finding is stadiums across the state are available at a high cost, discouraging many clubs. What is the recommendation? Make stadiums and grounds affordable to clubs according to their financial stature, so that clubs can organize matches and train. The third finding was, even the big clubs do not have their own infrastructure and have to depend on government-owned stadiums and ground for their matches and activities. The recommendation is some clubs like Cesar Goa, FC Goa, Depo Sports Club already have infrastructure of their own. Other big clubs should try and invest in infrastructure of its own and do not depend on government for everything. Government can provide help by providing unused ground for development. If every club has its own facility, the calendar can be out well in advance. The challenge is the ground for the calendar to be out of competition. The next finding is, for nearly 4 months during the monsoon, grounds across the state cannot be used. And the recommendation is artificial turf grounds are needed at least 2 each in north and south, so that competitions can start earlier and not wait for the rains to subside. One I would like to have it in Honda. Thank you. Okay. Any questions before we go further on infrastructure? anybody want to join?
Any questions? So I think we can move forward.
Okay, so that's the end of the findings and the recommendations which we will share it with GFDC and GFA to take it forward. I thank each one of you, especially the coaches and the audience who are there here to participate and to discuss and debate. Good questions, and we will try to see these recommendations which we have suggested. As I said, we will share it with GFDC and GFA. Thank you very much.
Well, friends, we shall take a short break, tea break rather. Let's refresh ourselves and come back at 5 o'clock for the closing ceremony. Thank you.